It's my pleasure to introduce to you Jessica Delena, who I have known for something like 15 years, and in multiple incarnations, and she of me. So let me just say a couple things before I hand over to the mic. Often when we do these introductions, you introduce someone's work. You attempt to explain in a few short paragraphs what their work is about, why it's interesting, perhaps how you should look at it so as to see what is most interesting about it. The idea is that someone who has spent a long time thinking about the work can provide this civic service of directing our attention to what may not be apparent on first impression. We do this so the person showing their work does not have to. It's a bit embarrassing or it seems bad form perhaps to begin a presentation describing yourself in the third person in this way. It's kind of bad judgment. Alternatively, such introductions are more like how we would introduce two friends to each other. Perhaps you're like me and you have many friends who occupy very different niches, little micro societies of their own. You know them, but they don't all know each other. If you were to graph it out, your world of friends would be several clusters connected only by you. Now, this means that on occasion, sometimes of our own choosing, sometimes not, these clusters fold into each other. Our position between them means that we are asked to ask ourselves to stage the encounter between these somewhat unlike worlds. We introduce friends to each other, and in doing so, we disclose the unspoken obligations of true friendship that we owe to each one, and disclose it to the other. A secret of that obligation, that fidelity to the friendship, is shared in what is now a mutual bond. There's some risk in this, of course. Those introduced sense that you are now making a condition of their friendship with you to transfer by trust alone their own fidelity to a person who is in fact a stranger. You ask them, in essence, to treat the stranger as a guest. When both do this, we both develop and invest a new friendship with each other beyond the triangulated obligation of their bond with you. When this happens, the shape of your own world changes. It's folded more into itself. What was more distant is now more near. And all your friends are brought closer to something like a single home. It's in this second, I think, more important kind of introduction that I'd like to make. Not because Jessica is not already an important part of the SCI-Arc community, which she is, but because it is more part of my obligation to our 15-year friendship to say that whatever interest, respect, or friendship you and I share, I would invite you, by trust, to extend that same obligation to Jessica, who is, without qualification, one of my very best friends. In this time, we are condemned, I think, to collecting our own families. We are born with some and collect others. Jessica and I have collected each other into a kind of family. She's known me for 15 years, which means that she has known many versions of me and remembers many versions of me that I'm certain have forgotten. These previous versions of myself persist more in her recollections and how she sees the person I am today through the appreciative prism of who I was. A friendship is, in some ways, hinges on that observation of having that supervision of the friend of you who knows you now past, close at hand. It's a way to keep the continuity of yourself intact, and thereby, this is critical, of staying loyal to versions of yourself in the past that you cannot account for, and yet who are, in truth, the ancestors of who you are today. Having said that, Jessica and Jessica's work do not need my credentialization to want your unique and serious attention. I am sure she would rather you forget everything I've just said before she presents it and during when she presents it, and I'm sure this is the right case, so please not forget what I just said. Jessica's work belongs to several trajectories at once, some that have to do with graphic design and some which do not. Like many people who find their way to SCI-Arc, Jessica is at once a very skilled designer and someone who uses design as an excuse to do other things, as an alibi. She can speak to these herself, but I would say that before she does, as I suggested in my own talk a few weeks ago, we may be seeing or may wish to encourage the formation of a new integrative, polydisciplinary forms of design. I said everything should be subsumed under universal interface design. That is one option. But first, I think we need a reshuffling of the desks. The categories of design, object, tool, scale, come to us from an industrial era. And in the real world, they are promiscuously mixed as a matter of course. Less so in the supposedly more experimental worlds of design schools and some of the design studios. One way in which which Jessica's work is part of all of this, is that she explicitly wants us to see graphic design as a form of spatial, environmental, and experiential design, as an irreducible building block of the city, not something that is merely smeared on top of the city or tagged onto the city later. We live in cities of color, type, negative space, pacing, etc. And at the same time, architecture cannot then be separated from its ability to both communicate itself visually before it is built and to organize our vision of itself well after it is built. This is not to say that everything is everything else, but that some graphic designers know that they are doing a kind of architecture because they see the city with a granularity of resolution that architects do not. She will show you some of what she is, she will show you work that she has done that is graphic design about architecture. But please know that this is an alibi, and I ask you to trust that alibi. Thank you.
Thank you, Ben, for a very personal and professional introduction. Thank you for having me. It's a very unique position to be in as a graphic design faculty at such a credential place as SCI-Arc, and one that focuses so intently on what can often become a sort of narrow view of architecture and the cross-discipline of design spectrums. The original title to my talk was that graphic design draw lines in the architect's sandbox. And I changed that original title of the talk for several reasons. One is to sound less adversarial. Without a doubt, my work is about design collaboration between graphic design worlds and that of the architectural ones. But secondly, that the talk is more about the process of developing a vocabulary rather than the specificity of that vocabulary. And as a faculty talk, I feel it's more appropriate for me to address the condition of being a student. So I would like to begin to frame this discussion by first looking at a scene from one of my main influences, Alison.
They learn new things about men.
Cheerfully how neatly spreads his claws, and welcomes little fishes in with gently smiling jaws.
Well, I must say, I've never heard it that way before.
I know, I have improved it.
Well, they learn a few things about.
While my mother was giving birth to me in the hospital, a production crew was present.
filming a news documentary about natural childbirth. At the opportunity to film a live natural childbirth, the crew was present in the room and they recorded my birth. The doctor held me up in front of the camera and stated to the viewing audience that I was a naturally born child, although in retrospect, looking back, it seemed very unnatural to be born on camera. Each chapter is introduced by a monitor about whom the following story is titled. The monitor reiterates the television as an active point of contact for all parts of the book, the connective tissue of the content. The chapters are collections of artifacts, photographs, and literature connected to each macro theme. This is an image, obviously, of my mother prior to giving birth. Like a conventional encyclopedia, there are primary texts which loosely comment on or describe the displayed artifacts. However, a majority of the texts are selected works of critical theorists and writers whose disciplines bear cultural or intellectual relevance to the content. The pairing of personal microbial artifacts with more macro-theoretical texts offers a compelling dialogue and exchange between the author and the reader. Ironically, most of the artifacts that I collected to describe my mother were tied to popular culture and media talk. As new macro ideas are introduced, the signal on the monitor begins to intensify, suggesting that more connections are being made and more information is being processed as a picture is coming into being. Camera focuses on the biology of media devices and the transformations that take place as a result of one's identity and representation being literally split by the camera's duplication of them. Here is an example of how the book choreographs a relationship between personal artifacts and the more well-understood theoretical works of familiar authors and artists. The image on the left is extracted from Marshall McLuhan's The Media's Message, while the image on the right is a 1970s newspaper ad for a stereo dealer in San Diego, featuring me as an infant. This is a timeline that has been formatted to look like that of a TV guide programming schedule. The chart fields are a cross-section between popular television moments and shows with phrases extracted from several situationist texts. While a TV guide entry reads, the nutty scene was a meaningful scene, lectures on how to put on socks and shoes and civil rights. The situationist entry sitting next to it counters an appropriate prototype for the decor of constructed situations. This spread represents TV guide magazine covers from 1976. Cover stories reflecting on banal highlights of sitcom culture. At the top recess in the hierarchy are more intellectually driven questions about politics and ideologies of television in general. While the cover story begs, what will become of Rhoda's look this season, the secondary story states, why the feminist left attacks television as entertainment. First, you have this record of how we identify with modernity through pop cultural personalities. On the other hand, you have an underlying current of questions dealing with the conflict our society has towards mass media. This spread features a striking ad from Good Housekeeping, where the television itself is monitoring the consumer, stating we'll return to our commercials after a break for the program. The chapter focusing on me is a confessional chapter, which discloses the influence this event has had on my psychology as an individual artist and designer. As an undergrad, the subject matter of much of my work was about the relationship I had to the televised image. The concluding chapter is audience, which focuses on the new media integrating into the mainstream social space, appearance, and spectacle. It accounts for the inventory of spaces with which new media and projected images has capitalized on. What were once considered spaces of intimacy now have an intimate proximity to televised feeds and pictures, intangible experiences. On this spread, T.W. Adorno suggests, the principle that what is experienced vicariously will have some effect on some people is an established one, and it is the reason why industry finds it worthwhile to spend millions of pounds on advertising. The book concludes with visual examples of what I call space invaders, and the broad spectrum of scales in which we interact with them. As 4-3-me is a rather conventional style of information delivery, obeying the visual and organizational cues of traditional encyclopedic material, developing a particular design vocabulary meant considering alternate ways of telling a story. This is ultimately the root of purpose in graphic design. Well beyond the presentation of graphics, graphic design is the orchestration of typographic structures, visual narratives, wayfinding systems, setting up a behavioral dialogue between type and image. The next step was to push the format of storytelling even further, and the story was another personal account. The second of these encyclopedic investigations of my own experiential capital was a book called Ground Uncontrolled, Disaster to the Power of Ten. Our existence is hazardous, our cohabitation is danger. As technology invades and marries with our space, a delicate dance between risk and safety is performed. On September 25th, 1978, the San Diego neighborhood of North Park was coded by technological disaster and debris. The book confronts events of catastrophe like that of the PSA 727, which fell from the sky and was disembodied on the city grid below, discussing a very real frailty. Society's reliance on successive systems is only illustrated by the response it has when they have failed. Using the computer interface as the skeleton for our design system, the morphology of the book is specifically derived from the path that the plane took from its in-flight status, 30,000 feet above ground, down to the autopsy of its debris at the microscopic level. At each level of the accident's magnification, the social, cultural, and physical conditions are presented. The design of the book begins with the magnification of one time and is titled In Flight. A simulated design of the book has yet to begin, though the traditional wayfinding systems of the book, page numbers, page titles, headers, are now appropriated into the anatomy of the interface. The design structure of the book parallels the content's reflection on the breakdown of systems. The more the book reveals about the historical disaster, the actual design of the book begins to break down, as it is illustrated that the visual development of the book relies on the stability of the computer software to come into being. The plane involved in the air crash was inbound from Los Angeles International Airport, headed for San Diego. The in-flight story begins with a historical photo essay of the two landmark airports in 1978. As with the previous encyclopedia, 4-3-me, the content of the book is an orchestration of personal and found artifacts, photographs, and texts, joined with the subject-relevant text from selected authors. The beginning of the book organizes content in compartments. The beginning of the book organizes content in a compartmentalized manner with a strict rationalized organization. Each new piece of data introduced conforms to the display of the computer system. For example, quotes by particular authors are presented in the form of an instant messaging window, definitions of term via an online dictionary, and factoidal stats as presented as system notifications. In-flight deconstructs airline culture, people's psychological relationship to air travel, and industry's influence on food, fashion, personal space, and social hierarchy. It describes airline culture as one of the great scripted spaces, where even the smallest surfaces have a design language and an international identity. It is one of the most highly trafficked spaces, where the possibility of emergency has been built into the design language, while other experiential cues are designed to Chapter 2 is titled 1970 San Diego, and it magnifies the event by 10 times. Prior to crashing, the 727 was preparing to land at San Diego International Airport, circling over the near downtown neighborhood of North Park, where my family's modest home was. This chapter was used as an opportunity to recapture the cultural climate of a Southern California city in the wake of the 60s and 70s countercultural milieu. The Boomtown Rats had a chart-topping song titled I Don't Like Mondays, a lyrical account of Brenda Spencer, the infamous teenage school shooter who opened fire on a San Diego elementary school. While the incident inspired the popular new wave hit, the social paranoia towards the school environment as a dangerous space has had a greater permanence. that thread this section both romanticize and warn of Southern California as a threshold for disastrous events, both natural, psychological, and technological. Mike Davis's Our Secret Kansas is featured as a critique of social phobias and ecological hysterias, and conditions that he cites as indicative of Southern California's relationship with disaster, cultural, technological, and ecological instability. Pop cultural hurricanes and disaster accompany this text, and has pointed out that the late great Lester Bangs was a native San Diegan, who penned much of his toothy cynicism for the music industry from his hometown studio, also the influential pre-magazine's original publishing operation. As a byproduct of the Southern California Sisterhood of Cities, 1970 San Diego couples an autobiographical account with the ironic echo of these accounts in contemporary pop media. For example, the 2000 almost famous publicity photo sits next to a family photo taken the year of the disaster. And there's a pretty heavy echo of two compositions in the upper right-hand corner. The photo on the right is my father and mother, and the photo on the left is from Almost Famous. The second example is a publicity shot for the 2004 Ron Burgundy film Anchorman, versus an actual photo of Harold Green, who was a popular news anchor in San Diego during the 70s, and the model for the role of Will Ferrell character. The muscle car design of the 70s elevated the automobile to a symbol of sexual power and aggression. During this period in particular, B cinema saw the automobile as the perfect site for high-risk car chases, horrific teenage massacres, and the possessed machinery capable of supernatural powers, as in Stephen King's Christine. Magnification by 100 times witnesses the advent of the mid-air crash. Due to substandard sighting abilities, the 727 collided with a small two-passenger Cessna prop plane that it could not see. Both planes lost engine power and collided on the neighborhood below, on my street, and partially on my house. Here, a shift occurs in the previously ordered design of the book. System windows are no longer compartmentalized, opening and collapsing to make way for new content. Instead, a grid begins to incrementally fall apart, and content begins to crowd the frame of the book with layered intensity. A collection of headshots that I was able to find of both the flight crew and passengers. In total, over 130 people died. There were no survivors. The eye chat window to the left quotes Paul Virilio from his book Unknown Quantity. To invent the sailing vessel or the steamship is to invent the shipwreck. To invent the train is to invent the derailment. To invent the private car is to produce the motorway pileup. And to make craft which are heavier than air fly, like the airplane. Also, the dirigible is to invent the plane crash, the air disaster. At magnification of 1,000 times, anatomy of wreckage draws parallels between the human experience and the expiration, between human experience and expiration, and technology, biology, and lifespan as well. A classic metaphor for this paradigm, the original script for Donnie Darko, has been included in this section with the following excerpt. The falling jet engine approaches the hexagonal plate of light, which accelerates downwards, forming a tunnel with walls made of swirling liquid marble. The jet engine passes into the hexagonal plate. In a series of inter-volumeter time-lapse shots, the entire suburban landscape retreats backward in a fury of speed. These are two representations of two different autopsies. The first is fragments of Pan Am Boeing 747, victim of a terrorist bomb. The second is a photo of Lisa McPherson's autopsy. Lisa McPherson was a member of the Church of Scientology who died of pulmonary embolism while under the care of the Flag Service Organization, a branch of the Church of Scientology. Following her death, the Church of Scientology was indicted on two felony charges for abuse and or neglect of a disabled adult and for practicing medicine. The layering of system windows gets heavier and heavier, maximizing the memory of the computer. Here, another significant shift in the evolution of the book's design and presentation of content has occurred. The top layer reveals a set of compared images. The top row are schematic black and white drawings designing the trajectory of a structural collapse from Mabius Wood's installation in the fall. The lower row is a set of black and white x-rays taken of the human body. The two sets of images share an eerily similar form and composition. The human body's structural DNA closely coded with that of a collapsing building. At this point of comparison, the computer has alerted that the book that it has run out of memory and cannot continue to function properly. Data is lost from other windows where normal infrared text would occur. The final chapter magnifies the event by 10,000. Microscopic beauty is the investigation. The investigation has left the visible surface and has gone deep into the abstract microcosm of disaster and accident. In parallel, the computer system with which the design of the book is relying on is failing rapidly, and its screen begins to hiccup and fragment. The system is literally crashing. While program code, the microbes of the system are exposed. The content has reached a state of abstraction and disorder, and the text have also become highly theoretical. James Chile's text, That Human Touch, relates that this kind of power, so easily taken for granted, lets minor errors wreak havoc in ways undreamed of during the horse and buggy days. Such errors can be the same kind you've made often, aiming for one button and hitting another, neglecting to do something you meant to, taking an impromptu shortcut. Before the system has completely shut down and the design language and content of the book are eaten away by a forced curtain of stretched pixels, the last text submits with, ordinary language is loaded with redundant information, not because we love to repeat ourselves, but because speech is often misunderstood. Repetition pounds the information through the barriers of noise and distraction. A pattern was beginning to form. A superficial conclusion was reached that I was consciously and subconsciously preoccupied with media representation, significantly its effects on image and space. The spectrum must be broadened, and it was clear that an investigation of personal influences must be viewed through a lens of totality, not stopping short at specific events. I had to see the whole woman in the person before me. I constructed what all students should and sometimes do, a design genealogical study. The result of this comprehensive family tree was a great creation, a catalog of all the thinkable outside influences that touched me in some way, a sort of design family tree. Through this collection, a representation of themes presented themselves as I attempted to categorize a thematic place of each influence. The result was the first meeting of my design vision in a book titled They Are Machines, Research Unpacked. The book is a research-based project that catalogs and maps the participatory influences of a graphic design genealogy. It is a considered and loosely curated collection of artifacts representative of what I consider critical social and cultural influences. The suitcase has literally been unpacked. It is intentionally intense, however, without a strict rigor or prescription. It is less about a refined organization and far more about getting your eyes dirty. In essence, these influences are mechanisms that drive cultural influence. In return, they become the parts contributing to my design persona. Serendipitously, They Are Machines points to the ideology that resulted from this study, which will be explained at the end of the book. The collected influences were loosely categorized into fictional literature, cinema, music, and performance, historical design, theory and movements, architecture, artists and ideologies, criminal influences, and what I call now graphic design. Although through investigation of the previous two projects, I had an understanding of a vague relationship with architecture, the specificity of this relationship or the kind of architectural topic I was getting at was still cloudy. However, I was committed to talking about it beyond the topical realm. I instinctually knew that the book itself had to behave architecturally in a physical capacity. The engineering of the design of the book had to echo a physical behavior like that of ground and control. Each representation of an influence and the idea that accompanied it had to physically describe the relationship between the two. The book thus had to become interactive so that the reader could experience the common qualities that a book inherently shares with architecture, that they are both time-based mediums to be impressed on the reader. Structure, boundary, dimension, and surface all articulate the delivery of information. The physical properties associated with each influence cannot be suppressed, but must be exploited. Why illustrate a flat representation of a CD insert when you can insert the CD itself? Acknowledging the physical qualities of each artifact imparts on the reader a magnifying recollection. The senses are imbued with the familiar relationship we have with these experiences and influences. As with the previous two explorations, distant artifacts were forced together to reveal how and why they could belong to the same ideological framework. New meanings arose out of these cultural collisions, and a postmodern sensibility started to take shape. This was especially harmonious with the fact that much of the influential collateral discussed in the book came from postmodern origins. The self-contained influences began to speak to one another, literally commenting on the other's point of view. Authors even began to cross-comment on their own material. For example, the introduction of the McLuhan phrase, "All media are extensions of some human faculty, psychic or physical," from the previous spread now means all media are extensions of the eye. Or, all media are terrorism and television. Romantic cross-pollination of McLuhan and the headline from the TV Guide issue, "One a media critic and one a media apparatus." When it came to the representation of architecture, I had to be careful about how to discuss this element in the room. I insisted on the graphical influences coming into an architectural being within the book, but having the architecture do the same seemed less than a worthy effort. Instead, I had to reverse the roles. I chose instead to represent the architectural influences graphically. I took those images of architectural significance and gave them a three-dimensional shape, which was then ciphered through the two-dimensional plane. What resulted was this blurry line between real and unreal, touchable and flat, an interesting intersection of graphic design and architecture. The theory and movement section of the book looked at those criticalities I found most significant. The age of information, technology, and image had produced a spectrum of proposed effects on the human body and our understanding of ourselves. These spreads dealt with the addition and subtraction of parts of body and image, and a selective revelation and hiding of certain parts begin to discuss artifice and surface, Frankensteining and prosthesis, these synthetic mechanisms operating below the surface of the real. The entire work seemed to echo the process of peeling back layers to reveal the fundamental order at work, psychological, intellectual, and most of all, physical. There were those influences that had no place in my collection, no neat place in my collection. They were vital entities that lived above the confines of the categorical plane. Nonetheless, their close physical relationship within the context of the book yielded staged interactions loaded with curious nuances. Humanity's rapid course toward more advanced and artificial iteration. greater synthesized relationship with its technology and vice versa. They are machines. The design persona split like an embryonic cell, dividing a set of twins, two individuals sharing an almost identical biological code. While they are machines spelled out with the thematic integration of the human body and technology, it also gave birth to a second yet equally important framework, that graphic design can and is experiencing an accelerated integration with architecture. That architecture is a body and graphic design is a software applied to it, designed to make the system outperform older models, a kind of post-design. This twin design vision will be explained further in the follow-up to They Are Machines, with It Is a Building, Process, and the Pain of Progress. As the models of artificiality, technological synthesis, and image mutation surfaced, the need for specificity again returned. Now the need was for a precedence analysis. What are the methods of transformation? What are its formal qualities? And what are its intentions? Where and how has post-human phenomenology been understood, confronted, positioned, and reimagined? These confrontations came together in a book called The Post-Human Gesture. The Post-Human Gesture, Ingestion, Digestion, and Expulsion is a book on books. It catalogs and describes several publications which make up the vast array of points of view on the ideologies and studies of post-human. Through the three-part lenses of Ingestion, Digestion, and Expulsion, from Alice Wonderland to Max Hedrum and Matthew Barney, the book itself is designed as an artifact that is also in the process of experiencing structural, ideological transformation. The book again behaves as an architectural body. Parts 1, 2, and 3 can be said to describe with what methodological processes its selections exhibit a post-human transformation, and to what amplitude that method has become complete with its host. Ingestion describes a remedial level of technological intervention and is focused on books and subjects where by some local act the body undergoes a mutation by consumption, insertion, or association. Through a specific kind of presentation, some of the subjects visually describe ingestive methods by inserting themselves into the biology of the book. As Alice is confronted with the issue of scale, her body responds to the need to navigate through the arduous and spontaneously shifting architecture of Wonderland via serums and cakes that she ingests, shape-shifting at will. Orlan is a well-known French multimedia and performance artist. She is regarded as the first person to use plastic surgery as a medium of artistic expression in popular art. Like Alice, metaphorically speaking, Orlan consumes the spectacle of the post-human ideology in order to challenge the security and permanence of identity. The body of the book, even in its mundane duty to capture and compose the text, echoes the procedural Frankenstein of Orlan's body. Dan Friedman's seminal book, Post-Human, illuminates the mutation a body undergoes as the cult of personality gets processed, duplicated, filtered, and broadcast via the devices of media. The cult of personality is entirely dependent on the deliverance of the post-human. Through the televised event, a bigger, better, and faster edition of ourselves is secured. Economics relies on post-human manifestations to keep intact. Again, the book design physically responds to the method which the selections have been identified. Here the spreads have been overtly edited, allowing only a highly constructed message to be perceived. Collaging, cut-ups, and layering become chief identifiers of post-humanism under the ingestion signifier. This spread showcases Christian Marclay's pin-ups posters as featured on the pages of Friedman's Post-Human, which is featured on the pages of the Post-Human Gesture. Digestion is the process of breaking down ingested material into parts, deconstructing it into exposed condensed form, so that its foreign physiology may integrate more fully with our own biology. Digestion is a more advanced and invasive incorporation of foreign elements not native to the body, and as such, the contents of part two, digestion, are of subject matter whose post-human methodology and display in the book are both more complex and interlocked. Prosthetics have long been the most obvious and familiar illustration of man's transformation into the post-human. This is probably largely the result of an aesthetic reading of flesh-bound people literally with robotic parts. A book I found overwhelmingly successful in discussing the prosthetic's historical relationship to the human body was The Prosthetic Impulse, From a Post-Human Present to a Biocultural Future. Paul McCartney's performance work as a life-size Pinocchio mascot hell-bent on his own physical destruction seemed appropriate as well. From Man Modified, the Amoroscope uses photo cells to feed electrical signals to a blind person's brain, allowing him to distinguish patterns of light and shape. Part 3 expelled the traditional understanding of what is human altogether. Literally, expulsion or excretion is the process of eliminating from an organism waste products, metabolism, and other materials that are no longer of use. It is an essential process in all forms of life. In parallel, expulsion points to a spot on the horizon where artificiality is no longer detectable, where outdated human biology has been pushed out, and the integration between humans and technology has yielded a new streamlined species in some way. Max Hedren is a cybernetic imprint for former living humans' memories, and personality belongs to literally live within computers, television programs, and other electronic environments. Matthew Barnes' Premaster Site exhibition catalog reveals some of the biological considerations that the conceptual films make about what expanded notions of post-humanism can be. Not all post-human ideologies are technologically biased. Some consider natural synthesis as well. In each of the films in the cycle, human anatomical conventions are destabilized, redesigned, and inherit physical exchanges with material and form to a Gaian degree. Expulsion also covers the exhibition catalog for the Tate Gallery's Heaven, the exhibition that will break your heart. While the exhibition focused more locally on religion and idolatry, much of the work framed popular culture figures in a superhuman capacity, supernatural, meaning superior to nature, iterations of ourselves and our desires. Featured here is Jeff Koons' Michael Jackson and Bubbles. And so each of the spreads, essentially, I extracted images and content from the books and recomposed them to suggest something about the book's content. So here, I would literally compose each spread by Frankensteining the content from the books that I was talking about. This brings me to design authorship, where graphic design and all design rewrites old ideas. The location and confirmation of one's design disposition does not dictate a profound uniqueness in the context of a global design community. It does, however, confirm the elasticity afforded by the fishing line of your ideas. As post-human theory becomes more than fantastical interpretations of our social, cultural, and physical selves, graphic design has the opportunity to participate in the redefinition of the body and space relationship. As our physical apparatus is synthesized with our technological ones, it is possible for graphic design to not only illustrate this fusion, but to actually do it. Graphic design can behave in similar ways that body and technology are now behaving together. How can graphic design become the materials of architectural space? Rather than masking or existing on the architecture, how can it be the architecture? The walls, the doors, the windows, the infrastructure, how can graphic design be produced on the eye itself? Specifically, how can graphic design facilitate the synthesis between mechanical and organic bodies? If architecture is the mother of all arts, then graphic design is the mother of all language. This is book two. It is a building, the process, and the pain of progress. It is a building is a summation of critical influences and their impacts on my design persona, but it's also a proposed establishment of a design agenda. It is a building points to the subjectivity of the agenda, reflections on graphic design as an architectural body, as post-design, but also building as a literal process for making this type of design. So this book literally became the process book with which I took all of the information and all of the what I had sort of learned about myself and my tendencies as a designer, where I had to now, instead of cataloging those influences, I had to now make something out of them, and I had to allow my design vocabulary to come into being with my own work. So I started off very rudimentally by literally cutting and pasting visual images together that were symbols or representations of both architectural space and post-human images relating to the post-human. And essentially what I was getting at was that the methodology and the way for graphic design and architecture to synthesize would be based on the modes in which human beings are synthesizing with technology. And through the end of this process, I would eventually come to a way to describe that methodology to build it. But first, it was a very sort of messy process where, I say fail fast and fail often. And I say this to my students a lot because it allows you to identify the problems with greater speed so that you can get to the solution much quicker. So these poster experiments were about, number one, getting at what the imagery actually should be, and it started off very collage-like, and like I said, Frankensteining the pieces together. But it wasn't having the same sort of impact that I was going for, because the poster was just a poster. It was not having any kind of synthesized relationship with architecture. So the process was about getting to that methodology that would synthesize. It would put the poster through the same kind of synthesized process that human beings are experiencing with their technology. So I started to look at angularity, dimension, foreground, background. And at the same time, these processes, while I was getting closer to a language that felt appropriate, it nonetheless was, hey, I'm a graphic designer who understands how to mutate images, and I needed to be able to let the poster design itself and remove the obviousness of my presence. So I began by asking myself, if human integration with technology begins at the very sort of biology of our physical code, what is the root biology and physical code of architecture? And in its simplest form, it's a box. And so I began to print out the poster and the images and wrap them in boxes to create this sort of little modular poster city. And then it occurred to me that the collaging aspect, what I had gotten at with the post-human gesture, with the transition from digestion to ingestion to digestion and expulsion, was not a process of adding, but a process of subtracting and streamlining the imagery to communicate that the artificiality we are experiencing has to be a more integrated and seamless one, the way that architecture, graphic design is architecture's prosthetic device in its current iteration. It exists as signs and surfaces on architecture, but it actually does not behave architecturally. That synthesis is yet to be realized. So I went back and changed, reconsidered the contents of the poster, the representations of post-human ideology and architecture. And then I incorporated the model city again. And eventually I came to a place where the seamlessness in the hand of the designer was no longer forcing the materials to represent something, but the poster was literally behaving architecturally because it was conforming to an architectural space. And because of that that mutation, these little dialogues between perspective and the mutation of the image and repetition and where artificiality begins and ends became more clear. until eventually I realized this poster, which I went on to develop this design thesis much more thoroughly and with greater complexity in a film that I had done about an exhibition that I created called High Side Sin, which was discussing the methodology of how these two things would come together through hybridity, symbiosis, and an eventual synthesis. But this poster really represented the launch pad for that really more broad and in-depth investigation. And AR Machines and Its Abilities was the final naming of that design vocabulary. So I don't know what kind of time we have. Does anybody have time? Okay. If you'd like to stick around, I will show my thesis, which was the sort of culmination of all of the material I've shown. It's a 20-minute film, though, so yes, no, or a few questions.
Both.
Film? Yes. No. I always get angered by speakers who give disclaimers before they show some work, but I'm going to give myself permission to do so. I was telling one of my current students now how ambitious I was as a design student and attempted to produce a great deal of material that could only be produced using technology I had never even touched before. So I ended up learning all kinds of modeling programs and editing programs on the fly while trying to simultaneously sophisticate my thesis ideas. So I do warn you, the film is a little amateur, but I think it, through the narrative and through the experiments that I generated from it, it'll clearly sort of simulate the kind of design process and design product that I was aiming for. I will say that my thesis by no means concluded or resolved any of my questions. In fact, it only exacerbated them.
You are human, it's true. You are a graphic designer by technical standards, but nevertheless, in your own egocentric predicament, a craftsman of form, function, and most of all, meaning. You are also a technological processor that you will soon no longer dispute. There you recognize crafting abilities, you are also a 21st century architect. You are inviting the process of mechanization into your home, into your consciousness, into your body. As graphic designer, you are realizing graphical principles outside of the two-dimensional trappings of X and Y, manipulating the experience of time and space, the experiential narrative. You are commanding the fourth dimension, the architectural planes. The evolution of graphic design is reconsidering its practice as belonging exclusively to the second or even third dimensions. As man's body integrates more acutely with technology, so graphic design's reach integrates more with physical space and time. And it is through this processing as a human that you are able, as a graphic designer, to embody the architect. You are a processing machine. Your graphic design, a building.
yield to the new schizophrenic environment is undergoing transformations, meshing with forms of technology, encouraging it toward a post-human future. Through the logics of hybridity, symbiosis, and finally an imagined synthesis, the human race is moving from a state of being human to transhuman and finally post-human. Similarly, in order for graphic design to address those same environmental schizophrenia, it too must move beyond the states of hybridity, symbiosis, and embrace synthesis with architecture in order to move from graphic design to graphically enhanced architecture to a kind of post-design rather than Graphictecture. Using the metaphor of the post-human, the exhibition will consider graphic design's integration with architecture in which the building is a body and graphic design is a software applied to it in order to achieve a more advanced iteration of itself. Both the exterior and interior structures document the integration between man and technology and are presented through new syntheses between graphic design and architecture. Hi, short for hybrid, Psi, short for symbiosis, and Syn, short for synthesis, each being different physical and narrative levels of the exhibit designed to communicate different levels of integration. A hybrid is a partnership between two independent participants. The forms work together but remain in their individual states. In its hybrid state, graphic design is a cosmetic applied to the face of architecture, a flat relationship of the 2D sitting on the 3D. Within today's context, humans are inherently hybrid creatures. We partner with an array of technologies available to us in order to accomplish a particular result. For example, fashion, cosmetics, computers, cameras, and most apparently, transportation. Persons and their automobiles are the most significant of these hybrid partnerships. This partnership, however, does not formally reshape either the person or the car they are driving. Likewise, an image that sits on the surface of a 3D structure is a hybrid relationship between graphic design and architecture that does not rewire the structural code of either the design or the building. Symbiosis is a mutation that occurs as the result of a partnership. The forms are now integrated further in an interlocked state and can no longer operate independently from one another, though their origins are still determinable. In its symbiotic state with architecture, graphic design is the formal equivalent of what is termed transhuman, an intermediary state between human and posthuman. For example, an amputee has a symbiotic relationship between his or her body and any number of prosthetic devices. The person may not be able to walk without the false leg, and the leg is virtually useless unless it is attached to the body of someone who needs to walk. Any snapshot of Times Square reveals a kind of symbiotic relationship that graphic design has with architecture, where graphic design operates as architecture's prosthetic device, structurally interlocked with one another, performing a function that the other cannot produce alone. until finally we achieve synthesis, a total union between independent forms, the complete fusion resulting in an entirely new form, where the origins are assumed no longer recognizable. A post-human is a hypothetical future being whose capabilities so radically exceed those of present humans as to no longer be human by current standards. It has achieved a complete synthesis between its original human self and its technology. These imagined individuals have undergone a total transformation on a physical, mental, and spiritual level. Although there are no public accounts of living post-humans, all of the arts have imagined in hundreds of ways and forms who they are and what they look like, from David Bowie's Ziggy Stardust to Chris Cunningham's lovemaking cyborgs to Matthew Barney's character of positive restraint to the pregnant man. Comparatively, for graphic design to realize the post-design state, Graphictecture, it must imagine how it can synthesize completely with architecture so that the new form's capabilities so radically exceed those of present graphic design and architecture as to no longer be either of which by current standards. Just as technology is a kind of software applied to the human body to enhance its form and function, graphic design is a software that is applied to architectural bodies for the same purposes. As a vehicle for many things, graphic design preoccupies itself with the business of conversations. It is a medium in the habit of the illustration of ideas, making social commentaries here, defining styles there. Graphictecture will offer a kind of graphic design practice that participates in the construct of the social spaces it earlier only illustrated, commented, or lived on. Elevating graphic design to an architectural role will yield new understandings of space and time, the way that elevating the human to a streamlined processor has richly yielded new understandings of ourselves.
Architect people who are using cinema.
second, how would you differentiate this stuff from that stuff?
That's a very important question, namely because of, yes, of course, there are many different design personas who have already thought of this consciously or subconsciously, or where this kind of dialogue makes its way into their work, regardless of original intent. I think that a lot of the design side of the considerations of the synthesis is still, there's a lot of, very interesting. In fact, I think they were just here yesterday, graffiti labs, or they draw, they give you the capability to sketch onto the building, which is a remarkable idea. At the same time, it still locks graphic design into the surface of the building rather than into the structural code of it. Classical architecture has always had typography literally milled into its surfaces. So that relationship is very, very old. I think that the intriguing part is that architects are really the ones who have a kind of love, a hobby love with graphic design, and there seem to be the ones who are really trying to promote, or at least, not for graphic design's sake, but for architecture's sake, they're trying to embed a graphic design language into the skins of their buildings. The closeness that I have and the proximity that I have to Morphosis, not that it's been done successfully yet, but they're always incorporating a graphical language into the actual skeleton or into the actual materials of the building. The Caltrans 100 is a prime example, albeit very sort of simple and rudimentary. Even a lot of the projects that we are competing for now is about looking at the skin of the building as a programmable space, instilling it with the kind of where you can actually, the skin of the building is a monitor itself. The entire skin of the building is one giant monitor in which graphical information can travel from one point of contact with traffic to another point of contact at will, and that you could actually orchestrate the space for events or any kind of atmosphere or scripted space, because the building itself is a large interactive screen. Other than that, it would behoove me to understand the people who are actually trying to build these things. A lot of it is taking place in motion design, but again, that's a controlled graphic space rather than breaking the laws of architecture and graphic design in the physical world.
I guess I was curious in the video you showed, if post-humanism was a subject of analogy there, or if it was also something you saw as key to sort of the transition.
I'm sorry.
If the post-humanism was something that you feel was it a subject of analogy, or was it something you saw as key to unraveling the issue of graphic fiction?
It was key to unraveling that's sort of what a thesis is, right? It's about finding the methodology in which to give yourself criteria and rules to build the hypothetical. For me, it's largely about process. There's two schools of designer that I've talked with Ben about quite a bit. There's the designer who is a form maker and can produce spontaneously outstanding form and beauty, but with which carries a minimal amount of investigative substance. Then there's also the school of designer who spends most of their energies on the process itself, and the end result is sort of arbitrary. I tend to be biased towards the more process-driven designer. Design is hard for me. It's very difficult. Form-making is very hard. And there's the only way that I can get there is by having a very sort of outlined process. And so I saw in the work that I had done, and that's largely what the talk is about, is this continual and repetitive investigation of my personal experiences and influences. And out of that surface, these two very integrating entities that I saw as being sort of mirror processes of one another. So it absolutely was integral to how I was able to even model some of the exhibits in the museum.
Taking apart all of those characters and finding out
how they were built, how they operate, what their social agenda is, what their physical representation is, and where do they fit into this methodology that I've set up. And then I just started, just making, and eventually you start seeing what's working and what's not working. Is it behaving, is the model behaving the way that the meaning is suggested? That's the entire point of the models, is that they must be communicating in their construction something about that which they're representing. So if they are communicating, there's some photographs of a famous photographer that I can't believe I'm totally blanking on right now, of David LaChapelle. He creates these very fantastical compositions photographically, and he uses personas that have mutated their body in some way with plastic surgery. So it's about the sort of reorganization of the physical structure. And so then the physical structure that represented those photographs had to communicate, it had to behave, and had to contort formally to relate to the idea about the content. So it was about building a giant matrix, really.
How did you choose the forms that you used for them? Did you have human form in mind, since you're talking about the body so much? Did you have an intention for them as being habitable, or?
Well, a lot of it started by taking a flat image and simple ways of making it architectural. So if I took a flat image and I literally stretched it this way, all the pixels in that one plane would stretch and all of a sudden become a three-dimensional plane. And the graphic design, the image on the surface, was now literally, because it was a very simple way of thinking, where the design ends and where the architecture begins started to blur. And so then I would just, think of just formal consideration, levels of integration. If it's a hybrid, then it's design that's sitting on a three-dimensional space. If it's a symbiotic relationship, then it would have to mutate and interlock somehow. It had to have a formal key lock ingredient. If it was synthesis, which were really the most difficult ones to get at, which have not been resolved, which is still the work that needs to be done, then it really had to, the viewer and the audience had to question where the graphic design